Well, we've had a series of racially charged incidents lately here in America, or at least ones that, that's how the media narrative works and the interpretation by folks. It doesn't really matter so much if that is the issue. Of course, the first one that kicked all this off was that situation in Georgia where you had the guy who, was portrayed as the gentle jogger, who was mercilessly murdered by a couple of Klansmen who forgot their hoods. And I think I went into enough about that, given what we know now and how that was not quite the greatest assessment early on. Early on you never really have any information on these situations, and people like to jump to conclusions anyway. And I've been trying to hold off on this situation now in, well, I guess I should say for a second, there's also this very dumb situation in Central Park, which has turned into some kind of racial issue where you have two upper-class Manhattanites, both of which I'm sure are immigrants to New York who probably work in pretty cozy jobs, walking around Central Park. One woman had her dog, and you know how white, you know, it was a white woman, by the way, and you know how white women are with their dogs. I won't say anything more than that. Well, apparently she's supposed to have them on a leash. Guy told her that, and she got mad, called the cops, and now people call that racist. Of course, she'll never work in that town again because that's now that she's associated with racism, that's how that works. She's done. She is officially canceled. And I'm not going to talk about that anything beyond that because that's dumb. But I should point out that is the climate that we're in right now is very quick to jump to that conclusion. I saw nothing there. I didn't even look deeper into it because it's a dumb situation. But people just chalk that up as one more yes, the white man or the white woman in this case is oppressing the blacks. And then finally we had what seems to be the most an actual legitimately troubling situation is this one in Minnesota, Minneapolis specifically, where this cop was kneeling on a guy's neck, and I guess that they choked him out. In that they, the way he was kneeling on him restricted the blood flow to his brain, and that kills you because he didn't have any oxygen. It's not that he, I don't think it's the way they do it. Although the guy was saying he can't breathe, I think that that's how you feel when that's happening to you in your body. But it's that your body's starved for oxygen, so you're gasping. But it's not that you're not intaking the oxygen. I think it's just that it can't be distributed because your blood's not flowing, because of how they were holding him. And this one, even though I mean. It hasn't been the amount of time that I normally like to wait on these things, but I feel like we have enough information to determine that this seems to be a legitimately really bad situation. Unlike the one in Georgia, which was, not a black and white thing. Certainly wasn't that the two guys were, who killed the supposed gentle jogger, who wasn't just a gentle jogger, in case you were wondering. While that was an unfortunate situation, it didn't seem to be, a blatant act of murder or assassination or a lynching, like people were saying. But in this case, the cops seemed to definitely be in the wrong. I guess the guy that they were trying to arrest was only accused of trying to spend a fake $20 bill. So what is that, counterfeiting? I mean, they were saying it was forgery, but it wasn't that it was forged someone's signature. They from what I've been reading, had to do with a $20 bill. So essentially doing what the Fed does every day, creating money out of thin air and trying to spend it into existence, but only doing it with $20. So when a poor guy does it with $20, it's a bad thing. But the Fed uses, creates, $2 trillion out of thin air and goes out and buys, treasury bonds or mortgage-backed securities or hell, shares in LQD and JNK, that's perfectly fine. But when a guy in Minneapolis goes out and tries to spend $20 on I don't know, buying a pack of cigarettes or something, who knows, maybe cigarettes cost that much these days, he gets thrown to the ground and choked out and accidentally killed. And I say accidentally because I'm not willing to go so far as to say that he was murdered intentionally. I don't know that, and I don't have any reason to believe or to I don't have any reason to think that the cops would want to do that unless they're just psychopaths. But the fact that there were multiple cops here doing it, the odds of all those cops just being crazy murderous psychopaths, goes down. It tends to me to be much more likely that these guys just didn't realize that they were doing was that bad. And that speaks more to the culture of policing in this city in general, which to me, is much more significant than if you just have one loose cannon cop who goes out and murders somebody. it's much more troubling that you could see, you know, what occurred in this video go on, you know, with four officers, from what I understand, being present and, you know, seemingly being okay with this. Now, aside from the details of this specific situation, which frankly are inconsequential in the context of broader world history, and I tend to try and focus on things that are kind of important. I don't like to just narrow in on individual stories to have an excuse to talk about things. The reason why I think, you know, it's important to actually look at this is because so many people in the country are taking it seriously. And that this says, you know, this is both sort of a reactive, but the reaction of folks in the country about this whole situation is indicative of broader trends in our, you know, sort of in the zeitgeist. And that, what, of course, I'm referring to is the lack of cohesion in American society. The fact that this is a national story is indicative that people think that this is relative to, or that this is relevant to their lives, that folks can relate to this, that, you know, because ordinarily, if, you know, if a cop's trying to arrest some guy and, you know, uses excessive force, you know, that's a local news story. The guy gets prosecuted, he goes to jail or whatever. You know, it's a person-on-person sort of act. But in this case, and in many cases like it, just like this thing in Georgia, Americans are blaming each other. Folks are looking at this as if the cop and the victim here are avatars of different, you know, political ideologies. Or at least I should say that's the way the left's looking at it. I really haven't seen anyone, because it's hard for me to tell sometimes, because, you know, on the libertarian side where I tend to swim, folks tend to, you know, be pretty critical of the police a lot of the time. You know, you see lots of folks, you know, who are kind of on my side posting links from Free Thought Project, and Free Thought Project always has all these, you know, lots and lots of police brutality videos of people recording things, far more than make it onto TV and become big stories like this. So the folks like me, you know, see this as a really bad thing. Your mainstream sort of conservative ink people also see this as a really bad thing. They always, on all these racial things, they always try and side with wherever the left is, just like in Georgia. They are always very critical of whoever the white person is. So you can be sure that conservative ink, you know, your mainstream conservative media folks are going to be against these cops. So then the only question is, since we know the left, the libertarians, to the extent that there are any libertarians, but there are some, and your mainstream conservative media folks are all against these guys, the question is, where does the actual right wing stand? Because the way that the left, you know, interprets this is that these cops represent, you know, the mainstream of the American right. There are lots of memes going around Twitter of, you know, hey, which example of kneeling offends you more? And they showed Colin Kaepernick kneeling during the national anthem, and then this cop kneeling on this guy's neck. And the point was to say that, you know, the right wing in America cares very much about their symbolism and their national anthem and all this stuff, but they don't give a damn about ordinary people. And specifically, they don't give a damn about black people. They hate black people. That is the point of this sort of messaging. But frankly, I don't think it really matters, because even if the entirety of the left and the right, agree that, hey, you know, this is a bad situation, shouldn't have happened, well, it's still riling up the left against the right. The left does not see that in this case. And when I say the left, I mean, you know, the zeitgeist, the ordinary people, voters, folks on Twitter, ordinary people. And frankly, I would think even the media establishment would view it the same way, that this is a left-right issue. And so it is ramping up the culture war. Even if they're only ramping up the left side of the culture war, it is happening. And each one of these events gets things closer and closer. And why is it that this matters? Because when you have this culture war thing heating up, you're just, you know, it's you're pulling on a rubber band. You know, it's like winding up one of those toy airplanes that you get at Cracker Barrel. You wind up the propeller enough, and that rubber band's going to get tighter and tighter and more twisted, and when you let go, it's just going to go zoom and spin back the other way 10 times as fast. In other words, events like this serve to build tension in America between intra-American tension. It increases the lack of cohesion in society. And when that begins to matter is when the foundation of society, the economic order, begins to break down, which we are now in the midst of course. You see, the ordinary people do not look at economic matters through an economic lens. Most folks don't understand economics and how the economy is manipulated and why an economy grows and why it crashes. All these things are completely foreign to the average person because, you know, they have their job that they deal with. They don't have time to worry about, you know, macroeconomics and, of course, all the various schools within it. And because plenty of people, most people who do spend their whole life worrying about macroeconomics tend to be wrong. Nevertheless, though, when they are negatively affected by economic change, by economic decline, that anger needs to be channeled somewhere. That frustration needs to be channeled somewhere. And the culture war is going to be that conduit through which all of America's frustration is channeled. And so if the entire economy starts coming apart, as I've been discussing, well, then you're going to have folks, you know, all across the political spectrum who are going to be in dire straits, who are going to be impoverished, who are going to have a lot of resentment built up against someone, but they don't know who. That's where the culture war comes in. It gives left and right, you know, somebody to blame. The right can blame the left, and the left can blame the right, even if they aren't doing it consciously, even if they aren't thinking to themselves that, you know, hey, the left has destroyed my economy, which, again, they have a point, they have a case for making that. You know, they can make that point. But even if they don't, you know, logically try and connect the dots in some rudimentary way, they still have the anger there. And that's when you get the potential for something like you had in Weimar Germany in the early stages of the Depression, to where you have folks in the left and the right rioting in the streets against one another. What was their real problem? The problem, they had economic problems. You know, they were both doing very poorly. That's why they were up out in arms in the streets. And once they got in the streets, they decided to take out their anger on their political enemies. And so, in my opinion, all this culture war stuff can ramp up and become very, very bad without ever breaking out into anything violent, so long as people are lulled and kept, you know, fat and happy by a faux economic prosperity. But when that facade of prosperity begins to crumble, as we've seen recently and as we will continue to see, then the prospects of conflict become more and more real. And so while it hasn't happened yet, and it hasn't happened this time and it may not happen next time, we need to keep an eye out now that we are in a depressed economic state for one of these situations to lead to mass violence. And I don't just mean left-wing rioters, tearing apart their own city and getting in street battles with riot police. Obviously, we've had some rioting in Minneapolis already. Now, what I'm talking about is what you saw in the 20s in Germany, to where you had, political street battles. And so, if this is just something to keep an eye on for the future. So if you gained anything of value to this video, I'd appreciate you clicking that like button and sharing this video. And if you haven't already, please do subscribe, because I do upload every day, and I'd hate to have you miss one. So I'll see you folks back here tomorrow.